receiving sexual gratification and ego appeasement from exposing the many obscene tattoos that litter his body. The designs function as excitants for fellow sodomites. Case 131, OX, age 33, heavily tainted by heredity. Father irascible, a drinker. Mother subject to epileptic seizures. Incarcerated for impulsive abuse of children, is without the normal inclination to the adult woman. Chronic masturbation since the age of 9. Hand in hand with these disorders of sexual orientation are morbid manifestations in the domain of work and willpower. The patient exhibits no desire to occupy himself with useful tasks. The weakening of the dominion of the will makes this type of psychopath especially dangerous. The relaxing of those restraints which keep the activity of normal people in well-defined paths allow random impulses to turn into action without regard to consequence. Although the patient is generally withdrawn and catatonic, occasional outbursts of violence take place. O has been known to cut locks of hair or rip swatches of fabric from the clothing of fellow patients. Case 132, Rose F., age 37, became ward of the state 4 years ago upon suicide of father, mother's whereabouts unknown. At one time, she was central figure of a controversial bloodletting cult. Even after extensive therapy, she continues to manifest the periodic muscular spasms and spontaneous eruption of painful lesions on palms, feet, and forehead that were once publicized as miraculous. These lesions are called stigmata, and like most hysteric symptoms, are accompanied by an emotionally charged trance-like state known as ecstasy. There are many recorded cases of psychopathic personalities creating bizarre symptoms for which there are no organic causes. This process may be considered part of the spectacular complex, a distorted need for audience and attention. In the normal adult, display of self functions as a preliminary to sexual intercourse. The exhibitionist, being a psychosexual infantile, is incapable of completing the mating ritual and therefore considers display to be an end in itself. The fact that a deranged woman was able to gain a sizable following is not surprising, considering her father's uncanny understanding of lowbrow showmanship and the public's willingness to believe the unbelievable. In the end, it was only through the combined efforts of state authorities, church officials, and concerned citizens at large that this movement was able to be safely aborted before any real damage was done. Rigorous hospital tests have eliminated the possibility of purposely inflicted wounds or markings, and it has been ascertained that trances were not drug-induced as previously alleged. Rather, it would seem, mysterious biological mechanisms were set in motion by the constant barrage of lurid fanaticism that flowed from the tongue and pen of the so-called Reverend O.A. Aaron.
There is a cruel joke we cannot quite articulate, jagged like the grit at the center of a pearl, a blinding irritation that advances from tree to tree until the memory bankrupts and the words fall out in formation. I am compelled by the very urgent, precise need to get it down in black and white, to document the life and sufferings of the little rose, and to map the curious chain of blood and crystalline teardrops that link her to the radiant thorns of her victimizer. Even now, as I am speaking, she evaporates. When the charisma of the rose is gone, the world will wither in the maelstrom of abomination. Have ever foretold that a child whose first halting steps were wrought in the headwaters of iniquity would find in these grog shops and tattoo parlors the formula for holy martyrdom? And who could have guessed that encased within a crippled lattice work of cartilage, there perched a heart so pure, evermore wanton to take flight in search of the fragrance of virtue. Every chart an icon of sorrowful mysteries. Every dermal hieroglyph a pledge of unceasing humiliation. She participated vicariously in the agony of the pious sailors who submitted to the inkblots of the Passion. And her appetite for suffering increased with each passing year. From a simple disease, we have brought forth sublime things. But these spiritual gifts might be nothing more than parlor games were it not for their divine purpose. Is the first flowering of self-denial. Since the spring of 1924, Rose Baron has not taken any solid food, with the exception of the Holy Eucharist. For the past 3 years, she has subsisted on a few drops of raw egg each day. When ravished by ecstasy, the accompanying lockjaw makes it necessary for little Rose to be assisted in her ovivorous ritual. Blossoming of the stigmata in 1925 served to stamp the little rose with the irrefutable credentials of her vocation of martyrdom. The pain of these wounds drenches Rose with suffering, and their edifying appearance has swelled the ranks of loyal followers. Many a diseased disciple have been stricken with health while clutching fragments of Rose's blood-stained gauze, which are given freely to those who cannot afford the donation. Unfurls the bloom of submission and exposes the reservoir of her selflessness. The body is reduced to the semblance of a corpse, while the soul communes on high, and the cadaver will move in whole or in part according to the purpose of the ecstasy. Of the flagellation, or yields to the invisible force that wrenches limbs into crucifixive semaphores. Often an ecstatic seizure is coupled with the phenomena of tongues. It begins with a low rumble in the abdomen, like the hum of a crowded animal, doubling and redoubling, a surge of voices in debate, pooling in the center and swelling, tide-like, gaining momentum, blowing and hollowing through the lungs, a great cathedral organ bubbling up, effervescent, the lost laughter of angels. And then a second song, fluid, warm enough to bathe in, and tasting of nectar. We witness the liquefaction of love and are compelled to open our veins to bleed in confluence. The chaste here in the Vox Angelica, only soothing cadences, while the unclean discern echoes of their own putrescence. They suggest medical treatment. They clamor for investigation. I'll not have it, doctors, armed only with the tools of materialism, are not qualified to administer in the realm of the spirit. They ruin everything. Go ahead. Sign your petitions. There will be no interference. I will refuse all visitors, even the most loyal of followers, lest in their midst is hidden the agent of our undoing. Now a whispering campaign has begun against her. They call her a dope fiend, an hysteric. Envy has begun to say that she is getting rich at the expense of her followers. Here's the opinions uttered against her, even from miles away. The house is on fire, and the wind of hatred is growing to intensify. Conflagration! Tribulation. It is the 33rd year of my only rose. And those of you who know the prophecies need no further explanation. Your days are numbered. Oh, you little people who gnaw sawdust in shadow boxes. Your counterfeit lives link arms around the globe like so many worthless paper dolls. I ask so little of you. Only give us the funeral of my design. The whole populace on their knees, faces scorched blank. Music notes crawling on living linen. Whipped zebras forced to jump through hoops of fire. And the pale white rose, a perpetual bride carved of cloud. Blonde like Amazon, bland like mannequin. I tried to protect her, but I unloosed the wrong knot.
Inflammatory pamphlets such as this one, coupled with constant isolation and near starvation, left Rose mentally defenseless, a victim of parental autosuggestion to such a degree that even today, the phenomena persists on the momentum of the past. The patient travels a delusionary treadmill, confusing real events with imaginary ones, combining fragments of memory with the sights and sounds of present institutional life.
Mr. Bones, how do you find yourself this evening?
How do I find myself? Why, I didn't know I was lost.
I mean, how do you feel?
I feel like a box of pulverized pepper.
Well, may I ask what condition a man is in when he feels like a box of pulverized peppers?
Yes. You may ask.
Well, what condition is a man in when he feels like a box a pulverized pepper.
Fine. Mighty fine.
I can see you're in good spirits tonight.
No, not me. I'd give up that stuff.
Oh, on the wagon, I see. Well, what's that bottle in your hip pocket, then?
Why, that's just a bottle of holy water from Lourdes.
Let me smell it. Why, this is whiskey.
Glory to God. What a miracle.
Thank you. and the next thing you're going to say is that she's,
come on,
she, you know,
come on. Cut the philosophizing.
Yeah,
get
all right, I'm coming.
Mommy!
What,
Mommy?
Sweetheart?
Mommy.
What is it, honey?
You look pretty.
Oh, thank you. You're a sweet little girl. Mommy's going to go on stage now, all right? Okay.
Bye.
Goodbye, hon. What am I supposed to say? What can I do? I was marked for love, and now I live to regret it. Maybe God in heaven could forgive such a man who swayed my youthful heart and caused me to submit to his fiendish treatment. Never. Why, every time I look upon my mutilated flesh, I cannot ever forgive him. He had no mercy. He cut and cut and filled my wounds with his foul ink until my very veins were clogged with it. And now, I am an attraction, Victoria, the creature whose pure white flesh was scorched with the flames of hell and pierced with the very needles of Satan himself. It cost nearly dying for you to observe. But have you any idea what it costs in human suffering? Have pity on the poor, foolish girl who submit to pollution out of the blind love for a human fiend with flashing eyes.
Now, why would he do a thing like that?
Well,
Hey, little girl.
Hi.
Where are your parents?
I don't know.
What are you doing?
Playing.
Have you been drawing on your sweater?
No.
Somebody's been drawing on your sweater.
It wasn't me.
What are you wearing under your sweater?
My shirt.
What are you wearing under your shirt?
My undershirt.
What's under your undershirt?
I am.
Certainly are. Can I play with your dolly, too?
You can color on her.
Do you like this mask?
It looks okay.
Do you want me to make your mask like this?
If you make it look like my mommy.
All right. Why don't you look in the mirror?
Hey, does it look good?
Yeah, I think it looks good.
Let me go.
That reminds me. Well. That reminds me of the one about the sailor who got married to the tattooed hula girl. Now, why would he do a thing like that? He wanted to watch moving pictures at home.
Ha ha ha! Tonight's Cinema 13 feature was made possible by a grant from Sims Clothing Incorporated and by the members of 13.
This week, television comes alive with the new generation of performing artists, alive from off-center. Shirley Clark's a rebel video pioneer. Now she teams up with playwright Sam Shepard and actor Joseph Chaffin for the gripping electronic theater of Tongues. The video revolution in the performing arts. Join host Susan Stamberg as television comes alive. Alive from off-center.
Drama by Sam Shepard, tomorrow night at 10:30.
When Henry Meigs fled San Francisco creditors for South America, he was the first of a list of distinguished expatriates who have since done the same. He built, and today is king of the world's highest standard gauge lines. Accompany Miles Kingston up and along the Peruvian Andes on trains which carry passengers to oxygen-depriving heights. Next, on Great Railroad Journeys.
A 60-minute getaway, Monday night at 10.
Spain in the 30s. To the world, it was a glorious battleground, democracy versus fascism. But those who lived through it saw terror and revenge. A bloody war with as many deaths behind the lines as on the battlefield. Then 40 years of fear and silence. Now their story can be told. The true story of the Spanish Civil War.
Women and laborers win civil rights. Tuesday at 9.
Wednesday on 13. At 8, the history, legacy, and grace of the Shakers.
I put my hands to work. And my heart to God.
And at 9, the 40th anniversary of a tragedy.
People who'd been close to the epicenter either simply evaporated or were instantly burned to a cinder.
Hiroshima remembered because the world must never forget. That's Wednesday on 13.
This concludes our broadcast day on Channel 13, WNET, owned and operated by the Educational Broadcasting Corporation, assigned to Newark, New Jersey, and serving the tri-state metropolitan area. This is a non-profit, non-commercial television station broadcasting 7 days a week. Tonight's continuity producer was Mary Beth Cunningham. Broadcast coordinator, Electa Brown. Technical director, Mark Bauman. Until tomorrow morning at 7:30, when we begin the day with a visit to Sesame Street, from the staff of the Educational Broadcasting Corporation, this is Tom Stewart. Good night.